Welcome to the University of YMCA. We're really, really glad you're here. I see lots of folks eating lunch already. I'm glad you figured out how to do that. We're doing a new system. If you're in the room and you don't have lunch yet and you would like lunch, you're absolutely welcome to lunch. You just go see the diversity ed folks out there and get a ticket. And we're doing that way in order to be sure that we're doing an accurate count and we're really paying nearly as much as we should be paying them for their awesome work here providing work. Providing food for the Forum Conversation Café series. I know lots of you in the room, Roger, could you turn this down just a little bit, please? I know lots of you in the room, but not everybody, of course. I'm Ann Rasmus, I'm Associate Director here at the University of YMCA. We are really, really glad you're here. The Friday Forum is a program that has been happening here for many years. We are going into our 97th year of Friday Forum. And we are delighted in the last several years to be working with Diversity and Social Justice Education as a primary partner on this program. Thank you, Michelle, for being here. It is now called, as our many t-shirts show, Friday Forum and Conversation Cafe. So we're grateful to Diversity and for the Conversation Cafe part of that. We're super excited for today's speakers, so we're going to keep the announcements really short. I would just note that next week we will welcome Chancellor Jones here for the forum, and we'll welcome you to come back for that. And then that will be next Friday. And then next Saturday, there's a great big shindig happening here celebrating the University of YMCA's 150th anniversary. We're super excited about that. There are public parts, well, the whole thing's public. There are ticketed parts of the event and lots of open parts as well, including a tree dedication on the front lawn in the morning. So we hope you'll come back on Saturday to visit the wine as well. Okay, Michelle, I will hand it over to you. Michelle is going to thank our long list of sponsors here.
Awesome, thank you again. My name is Michelle Macy, and I work for Diversity and Social Justice Education. If you have not gone out and signed in at our table, please do so, one, for that meal ticket, but two, you'll also possibly win one of these t-shirts. So I pick about 5 to 8 people each week that I email and ask for your t-shirt size, so if you want a shirt, make sure you sign in. And then as for our sponsors this semester who helped make this program possible, we've got the Center for Advanced Study, Center for Global Studies, and the U.S. Department of Education Title VI grants, College of ACES, College of Education, Counseling Center, the Department of African American Studies, Department of Psychology, Department of Urban and Regional Planning, Education Justice Project, First Mennonite Church of Champaign-Urbana, the Humanities Research Institute, Illini Hillel, Institute for Sustainability, Energy, and Environment, the League of Women Voters of Champaign County, Office of the Provost, School of Social Work, Sinai Temple, Social Action Council of the Unitarian Universalist Church of Urbana-Champaign, the Student Cultural Programming Committee through the University, Urbana-Champaign Friends Meeting, Urbana-Champaign Reproductive Justice, and the Women and Gender and Global Perspectives Program.
Thank you, Michelle. That's a lot. Okay, so a big takeaway, I think, from today's program will be, and this will get reiterated several times, the 3rd annual Reimagine Our Future competition is open for registrations. Okay, you're going to hear that over and over, I think, this afternoon. But I just want to say that off the bat. This is about the Reimagine Our Future competition, and we're super excited to hear about it. On a personal note, I really want to thank both of these gentlemen for being here and taking time to do this. It is a rare occurrence that I have somebody like Warren Lavey offer to do a Friday Forum, and so we were super excited that happened, and we're great to be able to be a place where they can talk about their work here today. So I tried to memorize bios, and today there is no way I could do that. So I'm going to read these to you guys. There's a lot of good information here, and I'm going to go ahead and share the information. So Warren Lavey is an adjunct professor in UIUC's School of Earth, Society, and Environment, the Colleges of Law and Agriculture, and Carl Illinois College of Medicine. After serving in the Federal Communications Commission and leading the global law firm's telecommunications practice, he has been teaching and assisting nonprofit organizations, including the International Union for Conservation of Nature, the Union of Concerned Scientists, the Sierra Club, and Metropolitan Mayor's Caucus. His focus is on the health impacts of climate change as well as sustainability's interrelated social, economic, and environmental dimensions. Warren holds JD, MS, and BA degrees. Leon Liebenberg is a teaching professor in UIUC's Department of Nuclear Plasma and Radiological Engineering. He is also a faculty fellow in the Center for Innovation in Teaching and Learning, the Siebel Center for Design, and the Center for Global Studies. Leon's university research focuses on development of industrial energy-efficient technologies, cancer therapies, including energy restriction methods, and developing novel pedagogies of engagement in engineering education. Leon has authored a textbook on energy systems, which Wiley will publish in March of 2024. Leon holds a diploma in advanced mechanical engineering from the University of London, a master's degree in mechanical engineering from the Imperial College of London, and bachelor's, master's, and doctoral degrees in mechanical engineering from the University of Johannesburg. So please join me in welcoming these two wonderful people.
It's the third year that we offer the competition, and it started off when I met with Warren, and with one of our colleagues is now retired, Robert King, and Robert is now Ireland, he's now in Malaysia. And also Cody Stern, who's with the Student Sustainability Council. We asked ourselves a question: are things going okay on planet Earth? No, it's not going so well. Why are we so relaxed when it comes to things pertaining to climate change? Why do most people think, if you talk about sustainability, why is it so that many, if not most people, think about that's about recycling or changing the light bulb in your home to a more efficient one? Is that really all that we need to do to become more sustainable? Definitely not. So here we have 60,000 students on campus, faculty from all over the show. Why is it that sustainability is still not spoken about as much as it should be? And why is it only so narrowly defined? So we created this competition to try and get a conversation going among our students and also among our faculty. What we're trying to do is the following. Michelle, thank you. Thank you very much. Michelle, for everything we sorted out. Hey, one minute. I'll just come over there. Thanks. Michelle, this is the last word. Michelle, sorry.
Can you just use the keyboard instead?
I'm trying to use it.
Okay.
Thank you, it's good enough. We posed the following challenge to our students. So we've got this global sustainability crisis, global. And you've seen maps like this, especially now recently on TV, where they speak about $1 billion of climate change events. Last year we had 22. This year,
technology is not on our side
today. This year, we already had $20 billion climate change events in this country. 20. It's only September. And it's a lot for sure. It's got to do with wildfires, it's got to do with droughts, it's got to do with floods. You know, tornadoes, it's happening in Hawaii, it's happening all over. But is that really all that sustainability is about? Just trying to change climate change, or to the positive manner to mitigate the effects of climate change?
Well,
we're asking you, students, and we were hoping the faculty would also become involved, and they are, to look at the following. Yes, climate change has a big deal or a lot to do with sustainability, but sustainability also has to do with poverty and radiation. It has to do with food and water, giving people access to clean water, the privilege to breathe fresh air, access to energy, electricity. How about quality education? How about inequities, dealing with inequities? Like you've been in this building with your wonderful colleagues, it's got to do with faith, it's got to do with religion, it's got to do with all these things. Sustainability is not just about climate change. If we want to effectively deal with climate change, we have to look at all the other interconnected issues. Poverty, education, food, addressing hunger, clean air, clean water, electricity, etc. So, in the competition, we ask these students to follow. Come up or develop alone or in a team a bold and innovative plan solution that promotes one or more of the 17 sustainability goals of the United Nations. We call them the SDGs. The Sustainable Development Goals, they're 17. But we're not prescriptive to say, come up with an idea about racial justice or about clean energy. It's up to you. So whether you're an engineer or whether you're from humanities, it's up to you to pick a topic.
Or not to work alone. I'm not doing anything. So, it's just like,
you see, technology is not the solution to our problems. So we're asking our students to look at these issues that they were. And these are the 17 SDGs of the United Nations. And you'll notice, of these 17 goals, only two have to do with nature. How pompous have we become as humans? Poverty, hunger, good health and well-being, quality education, and then little old nature, life below water, life on land. Only two goals. How pompous have we become? Of course, we acknowledge that all the other 15 goals, 15 goals are linked to the two others that are linked to nature. They're all interlinked. But, you know, if we get all these 15 right, climate action, affordable clean energy, economic growth, sustainable model, if we get all those right, but we live in a sick planet, what's the use? So we want these students to engage in deep discussion and to look for solutions to problems that they identify in any of these categories. This year we're very happy to announce that it's an international competition. It's not just University of Illinois and Nevada-Champaign. It's also the Springfield and Chicago campuses that will be participating, along with the University of Johannesburg students from the University of Victoria in South Africa, where I'm from, the Vienna University of Economics and Business, the Walden Sea Community College, and Zhejiang University in China. We're working also with Birmingham University, and they're extremely active. I hope they don't embarrass us this year with their competitors, but they are extremely active promoting this competition on their campus. Next year, we believe this competition will be even bigger. The registration date closes October 9th. So those of you that are faculty, please do notice on your students. The deadline is just around the corner. And you students, I'd love to hear from you. Please register. Even if you don't have an idea yet, register. We can help you to figure out what you can actually do in the competition. We've got two workshops that you can participate in, actually three workshops to help you with ideation, cool ideas. So please contact us, but first things first, you've got to register in the competition. I'd like to introduce you now to Professor Lavey and Leon. We'd like to tell you, to give you a little bit more context about the competition. Lavey, thank you very much.
All right, we'll be back. Yeah. Well, thank you, Nick. You did a great job. So we're very excited about Reimagine our future, the sustainability competition, getting undergraduates to think about sustainability and to share your ideas, you know, with the world, you know, through this competition. And let me just put this in context. The University of Illinois and Urbana-Champaign does a lot of good on sustainability efforts. Since 2010, it has had a climate action plan. It adopted a new plan, even more ambitious in 2015, and then a version of the plan in 2020 that we're working on now. You have good reason to be proud of being a student here, but that's not enough. Okay, so I'll just give you three examples of how you should be doing more to be sustainability students. So, within this Illinois Climate Action Plan, there are various photographs. Here's one. Does anybody recognize what's going on here? I won't call it. Just read the other. Does it seem familiar at all? So for many of you, you know, this is happening before you arrived on campus. You know, there was a system of geothermal loops that was installed on the engineering quad. And geothermal is a form of clean energy, you know, like solar and wind, and you know, lowers the university's heating and cooling costs, and lowers our environmental impact. You know, all of that is good, okay? But you're here as students, you know, I didn't see anybody raise your hand. You didn't know that this is here as part of your university. And so many of you got, t-shirts like this, you know, when you came and registered. And it's not enough to just walk around with an orange or blue t-shirt and point to buildings. And even if you knew it, say, you know, these buildings, they're, you know, geothermal. Yeah, that's really cool for sustainability. You know, we're asking you to do more. And here's an example of doing more. So this was the top prize in the sustainability competition last year. You know, students who maybe they were inspired by geothermal on campus, maybe you know, they studied it, maybe they just heard about it in the media. But they came up with this great project. You know, it simply stated just three pages. We're not asking for, you know, a dissertation or a long report. Three pages that looked at geothermal systems and the ability to extract from the brine lithium that can be used for batteries of electric vehicles. Now, how cool is that? Okay, so this team of students, you know, advanced different aspects of sustainability by developing, you know, this approach. And, you know, they went way beyond, you know, just being members of an institution that made a decision on geothermal. Here's another example. Another photograph from the Illinois Climate Action Plan. You know, great dining hall over in Uncondary. And again, you have reasons to be proud, you know, to be a part of an institution, you know, that has, you know, taken a lot of steps to reduce food waste, to have, you know, sustainably sourced foods, and, you know, trying to convey, you know, a lower environmental impact from us. But, you know, what more can you be getting out of this? You know, so, you know, maybe you meet here, I don't know, talking about over, you know, your meals, but are, you know, is anybody talking about, you know, sustainability and how it relates to food and water? And, you know, many of you are probably walking around campus, you know, having water bottles and whatever, and, you know, reusing them. And that's a lot better than, you know, having plastic bottles and just, you know, dispose of, even if you recycle them. It's a lot better, you know, to, anyways. But is this enough to be a sustainable student? You know, the answer is no. We want to get your thoughts. And here's an example. You know, so this is a second place winner last year. You know, fiber remediation nets. You know, a way of promoting clean water. You know, better than just carrying around in a plastic jug. Clean water through plants and textiles. You know, it's, they're woven together into nets that can hold back on pollution that would affect the availability of clean water for people around the world. Great idea. In fact, they did a very interdisciplinary approach. You know, they considered the economics of this, what it would take to, you know, make this self-financing as a business. They looked at it in terms of agriculture, in terms of the biology of the water bodies, and in terms of the chemistry of the water. Great idea, okay? You too have great ideas. Please share them, please focus them on sustainability solutions. And here's the last example. You know, this is a photograph on the inside cover of the climate action plan. So, you know, I ask you, is this thing being sustainable? You know, and this is what, you know, the people who put together this plan, you know, portray as the ultimate in sustainability for all of our students. And again, you know, the campus is doing a lot of good things. I don't want to, you know, criticize these people too harshly. But this is terrible, right? An image of a student riding a bicycle and with, you know, in a path that's, you know, shaded by trees is not an image of a University of Illinois student advancing sustainability. Okay? Now, you know, here's one, you know, example of going beyond this, and this is a third question from National. Native plants, right? So, there may be along this pathway, there are native plants. It's not enough to be riding your bike, you know, with native plants around and say, hey, I mean, it's sustainable, right? Come up with a solution like this student did. How can we increase the take-up of native plants, you know, throughout the world? You know, what can we do to package them, to market them, to communicate the benefits of native plants? That is advancing sustainability. Okay? So, just in summary, you know, if you're going to ride a bike, you know, have a bike helmet. If you're going to ride a bike, be on your pants and do so safely, right? That's good practice. And riding bikes does have lower emissions than driving on the car around. Great. All right? But instead of that kind of thing, you know, put on this. Put on your thinking. Be proud of being a student here. We're asking you to compete against students at other University of Illinois campuses, students around the world. What can you do, you know, with this kind of capital, you know, to bring your solutions and make it part of the competition? So, you know, just finally, Leon shared with me just yesterday this book. You know, it's pretty good. And, you know, the author goes into decisions. And decisions are made not by institutions, you know, like University of Illinois, or like the federal government, or like General Motors. It's made, decisions are made by people. And you as students have to start making decisions to use your ideas, apply your creativity to sustainability. And please help us.
Can you hold the book up?
Thank you very much, Brian. I believe this gentleman wanted to take an image of the book. Or
yeah, it might mention the title too.
Oh yes, the title is called Decisions for Sustainability, Facts and Values. Warren, thank you very much for that. I hope wearing your t-shirt or metaphors that you use at the program.
And you're listening up
to me. I've got a thing. You notice the topic decided, or the title, it's called Reimagine Our Future. Not Reimagine Your Future. So, Warren spoke about the students, please come up with ideas. But we're not saying this is your problem now, we're saying it's our problem. We're all in this together. So we've got 120 advisors that are ready to help you. They're volunteering their efforts. The majority of them are from this university, but we've got quite a number, a good number from industry as well. And you'll find a full list of them on the competition webpage. Let me just walk you through this. We've got several workshops available that if you go to this webpage, you'll see when they happen and what the topics are. Please register soon, if you don't mind, even if you don't have a topic yet. Seek the advice of the specialist. We'll give you a list of specialists that we think will be able to help you. If you already know someone who you think can help you, it's wonderful. You can use that person. You don't need to use one of the advisors on our list. You can use the other person, the person that you identified yourself. Then, submit a fact sheet. It could be one page or three pages like Warren showed you just now. We're not looking for dissertations. We're looking for ideas. We're sick and tired of people just talking and talking. There's too little action. It's time for action. We've got the Illinois Climate Action Plan, and this university is doing quite a lot to up its game and to become green. But it's certainly not green yet. It's far away from that. But there's much more that we can do. Our pedagogies, what we teach our students, should also be green. The way we teach students and the contents of the courses, whether it's engineering, whether it's history, architecture, the aspects pertaining to sustainability, those must be included. There must be a strong narrative in everything that we do on campus. Our courses, how we deal with one another. It's got to be with respect. Not just respect, you know, for ourselves, for the people around us, but for nature. So the finalists will announce in December 2, and we've got 14 judges that will actually go through all the entries. We've already got 100 entries, by the way. Last year we only had 190 entries. This year we're going to get well over 500, we believe. The first prize is $2,000. The second prize, there are actually two runner-up prizes of $1,000 each. The third prize is $500. And then we've got a bunch of specialist awards in certain categories, also $500 each. That's it. That's the competition. It's really fun. It's not going to take a lot of your time. We're looking for ideas. And thank you very much for giving us this opportunity. But you also said we can ask questions, or you can ask questions. But I'd love to ask you a question. How do you think we can be more sustainable on campus? What can we do different as a surrounding community, as an instructor, as a student? What do you think? Can I ask anyone in the room, please? And maybe you'd like to state your name. I don't want to put this person on the spot because I didn't know he was going to attend, but Dr. Robert Baird is one of the people that I first met on campus, and he taught me how to play games. He taught me about pedagogies of engagement, what he's forgotten and I'm still learning. Robert, do you mind saying something about sustainability? He's director or co-director of the Center for Innovation, Teaching and Learning here on campus, and he's been doing great things on campus. But he also teaches and coaches a soccer team of a bunch of young school kids. He gets involved in his community. Robert, would you like to say a few things, please? Thank you for that, Leon. I think it's up to our kindergartners and our undergraduates here to, I think you're doing, what's interesting is we have amazing professors and folks who've studied and worked at this your whole career, and your emphasis is on undergraduates and their ideas, because they're going to bring just a perspective that we things we're missing, and energy and youth in the future. So it sounds corny, but I say trust the youth, and then let's help them and support them.
Can I?
I'm youth with Western UPTD, and I have a prosaic question to start with, since you wanted concrete suggestions, but I do have a broader question, maybe I have time for later, which is, well, I think there's a lot of good structure, a lot of substandard housing around Champaign-Urbana. I had one of them, and I like to get into geothermal on the cheap. I don't want to drill a deep well. I have a sister. A lot of the older houses in Urbana and Champaign have sisters, and I'm just wondering if that could be a topic for somebody's exploration, just to repurpose a cistern as a heat sink, cool sink. So I don't know if that's too prosaic.
Thank you. It's
a brilliant question. I see some engineering students here. You guys just made them. And how about this as a topic? There are no cheap geothermal solutions available for residences yet. The geothermal solutions, which Warren spoke about just now, the cooling loops or the heating loops need to be hidden underground. But you also get something called air source heat pumps, where the air temperature can be used, even if it's minus 10 degrees Celsius. Even in winter with really frigid air, you can use the cold air to boil the refrigerant. That becomes more and more popular in America. They're really popular in Europe, but they're kind of expensive. So I'm afraid, you know, if you don't have $20,000 lying around, which the majority of us do not have, then you won't be able to.
Well, there are subsidies for some of those installations.
Absolutely.
But they're also on the East Coast and other places, there's hybrid systems. What I envision is using a heat pump.
Yes.
When I'm not using my gas fire,
yes.
And I'd have to have some complex
Absolutely.
Controlled mechanism there would have to be
a control mechanism to make this work.
Absolutely.
And I'll shut up now because have another question.
No, it's a great question, and this is an ideal topic for a team, a prospective team in a competition. This is exactly what you're looking for. But not only technical problems, it could be a social technical problem. You mentioned substandard housing. Are we really trying to quick fix the problem by just putting down a heat pump? Is there not a bigger issue that we should address? Should we be talking to the mayor or to the mayors? Should they both be there today and engage with us? What else can we do as a society? Why must we ask our students to come up with the problem? Why is it always with the solution? Why do we always run to the children and say, we created the problems, the next generation is going to fix it up. Come on, we can't do that. So we've got to figure this out together. It's reimagining our future together. Thank you so much. Another question then, please.
With geothermal or the panels on the roof, all of these things can be calculated to pay for themselves over a period of time relative to what you would have spent. So are there ways that you can find people willing to invest in the people that don't have the $20,000 now to invest in funding the future in that way?
Thank you very much. It's a brilliant question, and again, it's a societal issue. What we're saying is, none of these issues have a technological fix only. It's a social, technological, economic, environmental, political issue. All of our sustainability issues, from clean water, clean air, racial justice, affordable energy, which is green, they all linked science with technology, with economics, with environment, with politics. We can't get away from it. I can't answer you. No one in this room can. But collectively, we need to come up with an answer. And we need our students to help us to come up with these questions and to interview you. What are your needs? What do you really need? Not what you want, what you need. There's a big difference. And students like to think broadly. They always come up with novel ideas, but always. We saw it last night again. Students just think differently. They think with possibility. They have an entrepreneurial mindset. And the majority of students that I know are very courageous. And they make connections between disciplines that are, you know, disparate, not really linked. They make the links. Unfortunately, the older you become, the more set you become in your ways. That's really important to such patients. Very important. Is it federal grants that we need? Unless you go and speak to the governor now, is that how it's working now? next week the chancellor is going to be in this room. Maybe you should ask the chancellor what he can do to help. You know, I'm used to universities leading a fight. Universities are supposed to be the bastions when it comes to sharing relations, knowledge, and expertise with society. And I'm afraid universities all around the world have become really punch drunk. And it seems to me that they're just playing a game to get more students to pay their bills. Why isn't the University of Illinois a leader in the field of sustainability? We've got so many experts in the field. We've got an Institute for Sustainability, Energy and the Environment. Have you heard about them? I'm sure some of you have. But why aren't the technologies that those people are pushing, why is it not taking the money? Why is the university not pushing these technologies that you mentioned? Why are they not pushing it? We can come up with really unique local solutions that can catch on locally. Why is the university not on the impact rankings? In this country, the US News World Report ranks our universities. Oh, MIT is number one. Stanford number two. Some universities have jumped off the ranking system, like Harvard Law School, your alma mater. But there's another important ranking called the Times Higher Education Impact Rankings. And they rank the universities that are the greenest in the world. There are six universities in America that are on that list, and they're not in the top 50. It's European universities, it's Asian universities, it's Middle Eastern universities that are really greening themselves up. But not just the campus, the pedagogies. What you guys learn in the classes, your courses are sustainability oriented. We need to change, and we need you to help us. We've got a question here or a comment, please. Your name?
Thank you for your question. So, hi, my name is Ella. I work at the Career Center on Ray Street. Just so you know, there's also other career centers in your colleges, so in case you want to know. You asked a question about, like, well, what does sustainability, you know, what can we do to be more sustainable right on this campus? And I think something that in your response that you touched on, a lot of that has to do with like outreach. We touch on sort of like what is the bandwidth of every unit, of every individual staff and faculty member within our responsibilities as well of asking engaging questions. Because I know for me that sometimes I can't always think about, well, how do I make something green? The thing that I have to think about is my students are coming in and they're freaking out about like, I need to get a job. So I think in part of what is sustainable is also like, well, based on our campus environment and our individual services and who we serve, what does sustainability look like for us? I don't know who that is, but for my instance, it would be the career center, what does that look like in our location? So maybe a part of that just has to do with like either a formalized process of just maybe in the bureaucracy of things, just having one question to reflect in staff meetings, like, you know, are we doing something that's green? Are we doing something that looks sustainable and what that might be? Because again, that's just like a small question to get the ball rolling so that maybe other individuals that are staff, student, or faculty who are more passionate or they have more energy can like more, can dedicate more energy into that. So I think that's just my sort of tidbit on that.
Much of that. Warren, I don't know if you'd like to add, but the one thing that we're really pushing is dialogue. We need to engage with one another, and we need to be less fearful of one another. We're so afraid of one another. They say the biggest disease on earth is not, or the fastest growing disease on earth, it's not diabetes, it's not heart disease, it's not cancer, it's fear. We're so afraid of things. And we're so used to where we are now. Change is always difficult. But I always think of a moth, a beautiful butterfly. It begins as a caterpillar. If that caterpillar just feeds itself, it's going to become a really fat caterpillar. And it's going to pop. It's going to die. But if that caterpillar were to transform eventually into this beautiful butterfly, it will survive. And not just survive, but thrive. And I get the sense, I get the feeling, we're humanity, we're like a big fat caterpillar now, and we're getting firmer by the day. We've got so much already for everyone. Why is it not going where it's needed? Why is there a lack of urgency on this campus regarding sustainability? Why are you concerned about things like you just mentioned? We shouldn't be having this discussion. We should be talking about roots, you know, enacting things right now. Rather than talking about how do we demystify the issue of sustainability, how do we respect each other better and engage in meaningful conversation like we are now? You're really affecting how I'm thinking about things. And I hope students here might take this as an idea for a competition that they'd like to enter the competition. I don't know. Warren, would you like to be so pleased? Thank you.
So, you know, thanks for the question about the career center. I think it's a great point, but, you know, I ask you to think bigger, right? So it's not what your unit can do to be green, you know, like using 100% recycled copy paper. Or, you know, making sure you turn off the lights and you know, your PCs at the end of the day. Fine. Yeah, you should be doing all of that. But, you know, careers in sustainability, careers throughout fields like engineering, education, agriculture, economics, biology, you know, are looking for students who have a sustainability focus and sustainability skills, right? And that's really where our career center can gain leverage, make a real difference. Bring in, you know, those companies that want to hire our students to do research on whether, you know, whether it's a, you know, implementing a new communications program, or new technology, or, you know, having accounting skills, you know, that can be related to environmental and social issues, not just financial issues. But, you know, our students are facing careers in a wide range of fields where they are going to be challenged by not just climate change, but all these other areas of sustainability, you know, whether it's in terms of access to good health or gender equity, whatever. And yet, whatever, it's not so much you know, you acting as a unit of the university in your own operations, but helping students connect with their future. And to understand that during these years when they're undergraduates here, they should do whatever they can to gain the expertise, the perspective, the frameworks that will allow them to be successful in their careers.
Okay, now you can hear my voice. My only comment to that is that we talk about undergraduates, but what about opportunities specifically for non-traditional students, for students who are interested who are in graduate school or in PhD, or even staff development opportunities? That is actually the only thing that I am worried about, is probably that.
I think someone should take it up as a competition thing. This is about a competition. You raise really important points. How can we get this going? How can the undergraduates help us to address that problem? I don't know. We don't have solutions yet. Can I ask for maybe a last question or comment?
I looked through the Institute's unit, and it's impressive how many people are on board with it, but I mentioned in your introduction you're adjunct. I'm just wondering how many full professor tenure, because I see that as related to fear. I mean, I think there's a suppression of some of the hard things that need to be talked about, particularly to the agricultural units, when you think about what needs to be done to be sustainable. I think that, well, the point made, I think.
Sure.
That's a tough point. I've only been on this campus for 4 years. I've taught in Switzerland, I've taught in South Africa since 1980. And I was kind of shocked when I came to America and I saw how the academic system is being gamified. If you become a tenure, if you have a tenure track, you're an assistant professor, I'm not a tenure, I'm a teaching. I'm on a teaching track. So they can keep me out on 1 year notice. So I've got a 1 year renewal, contract renewal, tenure track to live for life. I can't understand how this system is so well gamified. That young assistant professors, they must play the game, they must publish, they must teach okay, but they can't open their mouths too much, else they might be punished on the system. You are dead right. I see this on a weekly basis. Especially the faculty on the tenure track are afraid to become too well-known, to become too contentious with their issues, or to raise their voices too much. They're afraid of the boomerang coming back. And when they become full professors, well, now they're coming in their 40s, they're well established in their careers, and why worry about sustainability or whatever. They worry about the career. They need to earn a really good salary because they've got kids going to school, etc. So, and the game just keeps on going. There are exceptions, of course, but the system has so been gamified. And I can only speak with the country so I agree. The academy is not well.
Another question from the Chancellor.
Another question from the Chancellor next week. Thank you.
So obviously like the competition is a way that the students can be engaged, but how do you think the students can put pressure on the university to be more sustainable, and whether that be like native plantings on campus or like the university divesting from fossil fuels? Are there ways that students can kind of pressure?
I'd like to ask you that question. That's why we came up with this competition. We need your brilliance, your innovative ideas. Come to next week's session with a chancellor of the year. He's a really nice gentleman. But if you don't tell
people,
if you don't talk to people and engage with them and tell them you have a problem or that there is a problem, they think everything's hunky-dory. If you don't write to our politicians, our state senators, etc., why worry? They're going to be re-elected. As long as the people are deemed to be happy, they're just going to continue. Make your voices heard. I'm not saying stem cells are evolution, but don't just sit and expect things to change. You don't participate in the communication process. Sorry.
Yeah, so I'm actually the YMCA student board president, so I'll be the one introducing the chancellor next Friday. So, I mean, I hope this question does get brought up.
So, first of all, that's great. And one way that you can advance sustainability is to get involved in programs that walk together more people. Sustainability is everything from what you're doing with immigrants to educational justice to the environment and whatever. And then there are opportunities. So we're partnered with the Student Sustainability Committee. Our students contribute about $18 a year in fees that go into a fund that is managed by students to make decisions and grants for advancing sustainability. That's a great way for students to get involved. There are other ways, other organizations. And for motivated students, they can find plenty of opportunities in the university of Houston. And what we're trying to do is to reach other students. And this extracurricular competition runs for just 6 weeks. Put together a 3-page fact sheet. It doesn't involve a lot of time. And maybe we can get more students to think about sustainability. Yeah, so.
Hello, my name is Gracia from Brazil. In this talk, my first thought is about livestock. Because in Brazil, our forests are being destroyed by the big farmers because of our meat. We export to many countries. And like here, I think we have to talk more about this. Like many people saying, let's save the Amazon, but having cheese and meat and beef. So I think we have to talk more about this.
Yes, in our competition, we invite students to identify a sustainability challenge anywhere in the world. One of the winners last year looked at deploying agrivoltaics in Ethiopia. A winner the year before that looked at gender education in India. And another one, the fast fashion industry in Bangladesh. Please get Brazilian students who know about what's happening to the rainforest, about the power of the agricultural corporations and government, to identify not just the problem, but what could be the solutions. And they don't have to actually implement them. They don't have to save 100 square miles in order to a competition, but come up with a step that they have an idea on, as a part of the solution. So yes, we want more people to be concerned about what's happening in Brazil and the effects of loss of livestock every now and then. It's all around the world, that's right.
I just want to take it exactly that. It's not a Brazilian problem, it's a look. It's not a Brazilian problem, it's a world problem, it's a global problem. What happens in the low forest happens to me as well. And it's happening in the low forest because of the way we live in the Western world. Why are the plantations, why are the trees being cut down and replaced with palm trees or with other types of agriculture? Because you need to export to feed the world. So I'm part of that problem. But what we say is we're part of the solution. Let's reimagine our future, your future, our future together. And let's get the students together to raise your issues that you spoke about, which are so important. And let's look at it from different perspectives. Let's get the undergraduate students to help us to see things differently, to reimagine the future. Well, I'd like to thank you for your time. And thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you again to both of you. And thank you everybody for coming. We'll see you next week.